And now it is my great honor to introduce you to our keynote speaker, Troy Vincent. He's Executive Vice President of Football Operations for the National Football League. Inspirational, intelligent, compassionate, a visionary, and a man of great integrity, just some of the words and phrases frequently used to describe Troy. A perennial All-Pro during a 15-year NFL career with an outstanding record of achievements in business, sports, and community service. His body of work is exemplary in promoting collaboration, professionalism, cultural change as standards of excellence for the game of football and for the community. Let's now watch. It is my honor to welcome to the stage Troy Vincent. Please give him a big round of applause. We're so happy you're here today. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Where shall I begin? Felt like homecoming. Well, let me begin by just one thanking. I want to thank Pat for your hospitality. Linda, thank you for your hospitality yesterday. I want to thank the board. Katie, I want to thank you. All of the volunteers, I want to say a special thanks to you, because without you, events, those who are in true need, your countless hours that you provide for the shelter, those things that no one sees, I can't thank you enough. And I speak on behalf of the families that are hurting, that have no voice. I just want to thank you. So again, it's been a whirlwind. It's always interesting. And I always have, you know, put together some formal thoughts. So this is my 25th year in the field of advocacy work. So once I went on and I was old enough and physical enough to actually take on what I would consider not even a man at the time, but once I got to college at the University of Wisconsin, I know Cindy Alvarez is here. Your husband, my coach, Coach Alvarez, was a magnificent role model in my life, and I've had many others, but it was that time, I was 18, when I began to go around the different cities, starting in Trenton and visiting shelters. And at the time, we didn't actually have shelters in the city of Trenton. It was the YMCA's team posts, for those that are from the Northeast. It was team posts. We even had the YWCA. Those were places where women and displaced families would go. Actually, the Salvation Army was a location that we considered in the city as a place. And I would just visit women that looked like my mom. I would walk across the city, 4 and 5 miles, dribbling a basketball, and I was young at the time, and each of the executive directors that were leading those organizations, because I was a minor, there were certain things that I was supposed to be exposed to, wasn't, but they knew my situation, and they allowed me to come in, and all I wanted to do was put my arms around the lady. I didn't want to say anything, but just ask God to transfer her pain into my heart. So that's where my journey began. So yesterday I had an opportunity to visit the shelter. And let me tell you, 26, 25 years, I've traveled all around the world. I have been to hundreds and hundreds of shelters. I've never been exposed to one that is more comprehensive than what I experienced yesterday. Typically, it's one or the other. Most, it's they don't have children. Many can take in the adult, but not the children. Many can take in the adult, the children, and not the animal. Many aren't providing legal services, the counseling. I saw, as we would say, the cradle to the grave is a term that we use. And when you start talking about the help and the support that our families need, let me tell you, what you all are doing, your presence here today, you're making it happen in Naples. It is happening because of your efforts, your support, and what you're doing. So it was awesome. Had a chance to speak to some kids. So some of the kids that were available yesterday, and we know kids, they're just as raw and direct as they possibly can be. They're not ashamed. And I sat down for a few minutes and had a chance to interact with some of the kids, which is always a blessing because I always see myself in them. So looking at the young ladies and the young men, knowing the pain that's in their heart and just trying to find some kind of joy during the day to remove what those images and sounds could be like. So the visit was outstanding. I met a couple Patriots fans. Can I show of hands, those from New England? Congratulations. They always remind me where I'm at and who they are. I felt right at home. A ton of folks from the Philadelphia area. So we have a good portion of some Eagles. There's always, and nothing, this is nothing personal, but you always find a Cowboy fan. You always find the Cowboy lovers. So they also were here. But again, it's been a wonderful morning. Typically when I go, the spirit of the room tells me what I should talk about. Because I've been doing it for so long, I can smell, as they would say, as grandma would say, you can smell BS when you see it and smell it. And if the people are really genuine, but let me tell you, ladies, you look beautiful. And the spirit and the energy from what I saw from the time I walked in the lobby, the discussions I've had about how each individual is sharing a little bit of them, whether it's resources, their volunteer time, that's special. That's what makes it work. So a little bit about my journey. And I just want to share, so this past May, and I have so many stories, I did an op-ed piece, wrote a little bit about it in the paper yesterday. I hope they captured it the right way, I think they did, but I was working with the domestic violence hotline. Katie Jones and I do a lot of work together in Austin. So I was doing she asked me to play a part in a Shakespeare play. And the parallels of Shakespeare during that time and violence and power amongst women, there's a lot of parallels. So they gave me a scene, myself and five other victims, and we all had a part in the play, and I just want to read to just give you a picture of, just a small picture of my lens as I went on this and began this life's journey. So this was a scene from a Shakespeare play. This is May 11th. Now, I knew it by heart then, but there's so many things going through my mind here. I got a couple cheat sheets and a couple notes, but I just want to read you my scene, and it just shapes a picture of my journey. Domestic violence was a way of life in my home. As a 6 and a 10-year-old little boys, my brother and I listened helplessly many nights from the closet or under our bed in a small apartment while my mother was yelled at and beaten by Sam. The fighting would start with my mother by saying she was not going to take her boys and leave. And he would tell her she wasn't going anywhere. From there, things would escalate and almost always end in a physical confrontation. When it was all over, my brother and I would come out of our hiding place and pick up the pieces by making ice packs for my mom or calling 911 if things got really bad. Growing up, this was my visual of a relationship. And I remember thinking, does this ever end? Is this the way things are supposed to be? Normal for kids meant coming home after school and playing in the park. My normal meant coming home after school wondering if this would be the night that we visit the hospital again. Then one summer day, things changed. My brother and I would typically see the tail end of the fight. But this time, we would witness things firsthand. We were in the living room, and the fighting started. My mom told Sam that we were leaving. He asked once again, "Where are you going?" And she told him, "I'm taking my boys, and we're going to my mother's house." He told her she wasn't going anywhere. Things escalated quickly, and he began beating her while we watched. As my brother and I stood frozen, my mother pleaded with him to stop because we were watching. He simply didn't care. He continued beating her as my mother yelled. He beat her until he physically was exhausted. All I could think about was how much longer would this go on? He literally sat beside her in a puddle of blood, physically exhausted. That was the only thing that stopped him from beating her. I was 10. This is just one story, but this was an image from 8 until I was 16. So this just went on. The normal, and again, I'm not trying to paint. I just want to give you just a little visual where young men and women, young boys and girls in middle school would want to come home and play in a park. I fed my mother from a straw for exactly 9 months. At the time, they weren't, her whole face had, every bone in her face was shattered. And the cast at the time cast her face, cut the eyeballs, nose so that she can breathe, and they would cut a hole for her mouth. And that's how I fed my mother for 9 months. No child should ever endure that. So this has been my journey. I promised my mother, and boy, I've done, myself and my wife, been married for 24 years. My beautiful wife, Tama, we have 5 children. We've seen the whole circle. So I've been exposed at that level with my own mother. Then as God has allowed other things to happen to me, my daughter, being sexually assaulted by a family member. My son being sexually assaulted under the watch of a family member. And the patience in his shelters, though we never had to go to a physical shelter, but the counseling and the support that's needed to keep your wife up when your son and daughter has been violated. So this has been my charge. This has been our fight. Now me and my daughter, we work together on these issues. So now Desiree is happily married. She's living in Detroit. And now we can take on these issues together as a family. So just wanted to paint a little picture. How did this guy get here? He's associated with the National Football League. I never talk about the NFL because this fight has gone on long before my time as a professional athlete. And it will go on. I promise my mother and I promise my daughter until the day that the good Lord takes me home. And I hope that doesn't offend anyone. I love Jesus Christ. That I will fight on behalf of those who can't fight for themselves. I will lend my voice and my platform to every woman and child that can't fight for herself. So that's kind of my story in a nutshell. Now, to the men. So this is not to exclude any of the ladies that are present, but I really have to speak directly to the men. Because the audience is the same across the country. So in my pastime, when I'm not working, this is where I'm spending my time conducting workshops for young men, teaching, engaging, trying to align young men to raise the next generation of men in the areas of domestic violence and sexual assault. But the audience, they remain the same. They look the same. Until we as men accept that this is a man's issue. The women have been holding it down, have been taking care of the family and our communities for centuries and decades. This is not a woman's issue. Until the demographics change in the rooms where the men are the majority at the table, where the men are volunteering their time, the women, our wives, our significant others should not have to drag us out here to attend. This is our issue. And until we take full responsibility for our communities, our granddaughters, our daughters, our nieces, it's going to remain the same. Now, I'm just going to assume that many of us are here, business leaders or have sold businesses, and we do pretty well. So we like to use a term in our office, KPIs, key performance indicators. That's familiar language, or ROIs, return on investments. And research allows us and dictates what we do in our workplace. What does the data say? How many of us have heard, what is the data telling us about our market? What is the data telling us on where we should be engaging? So let's talk about the facts. And I'm speaking directly to the men here, because this is what the data is telling us across our great nation. These are the facts that should drive us in our business decisions or our social decisions. In the United States, every 9 seconds, a woman is assaulted or beaten. Okay, that's a fact. Every 9 seconds. Linda referenced this. One in every three women is abused during her lifetime. These are facts, men. These are facts. One in every 9 seconds, a woman is beaten or assaulted. One out of every three women will be abused during her lifetime. Domestic violence is the leading cause of injury to women, more than car accidents, muggings, rapes combined. Let me repeat that. Men, this is the data. What is the data telling us? What the research telling us? Man, there's a war on women, and we got to stand up and fight for them. 10 million children. I think Linda referenced 15. I'm just going to give you the basement. 10 million children will witness some form of domestic violence each year in the United States. I was one of those 10. Nearly one in every five teenage girls say a boyfriend has threatened her with violence or some form of self-harm if presented with a breakup. That's your granddaughter. That's your niece. That's your daughter. One out of every five, it's in all of our communities. Men, the data's telling us we got a war on women. There's an assault and a war on women. What are we doing? Every day, more than three women are murdered by the hands of their husband or boyfriends. Every day. What are the facts telling us? In our places of work, data drives us. It's not, we got to drive, it has to drive us here. Men, Linda referenced this. Men are two times as likely to abuse their wives if they witness domestic violence as a child. Two times as likely. Thank God I'm like not like the animal that I saw. Now, I have a younger sibling. I can't say the same for him. I'm not saying he's an animal, but we live two totally different lifestyles. But our young boys are two times as likely to abuse their wives if they witness domestic violence as a child. Those are the facts. And this is not to exclude any woman that's sitting here, because you've been, as we would say, you've been holding it down. You've been doing everything you can, and it was time for you to leave. Your heart said no. Men, I'm speaking directly to you. This is your challenge. This is our call. And until we change the demographics in our room, until we start pulling our grandsons in and going in and sitting and listening, we're not going to change these statistics. And we're going to continue to keep getting the same results. Now, as I come to a close here, there are 10 things that I would like to share with the men to prevent violence against women and girls. Just 10 items. We as men, we must approach violence as women as a men's issue. View our allies and empower bystanders who can create a culture shift within our communities. Two, create an educational environment using our sphere of influence to discuss healthy, respectful relationships. We must model as men healthy, respectful manhood to our younger men and boys within our communities and workplace. Men, we must be allies to women who are working to end all forms of violence against women and girls. We have to be their allies. Look at the room. They're showing up. And they continue to show up across this country. Have the courage. We as men must have the courage to look inward and question our own attitudes that support violence and discrimination against women and girls. This is one I speak to my boys about all the time. Don't laugh at jokes that support violence against women and girls, because it's not funny. Humor lends to the veneer of acceptability to behavior that is not acceptable. Think about all the discussions that we're in, men, where we actually allow the small minority in our presence to say things that are disrespectful or harming the women, and we do nothing. We have to change that, or we're going to continue the cycle. We as men, ask if you can help if you suspect someone is being abused or has been sexually assaulted. Encourage your workplace or your place of worship to create a policy that promotes sanctions that prevent violence against women and girls. This is one that in the locker room, as we talk about and we go through training, men, when are we going to have the courage to confront men who disrespect or are abusive? What is our silence is consent. This is a challenge here. When are we going to have the courage to actually confront when we allow men to take on this form of abuse in our presence? When are we going to confront that? Then lastly here, let's speak up and educate others about respect and honor towards women. That's our responsibility as men, as business leaders, as fathers. And then I'll close with this. Violence against women and children is a choice. I think I shared that with a few others here. Violence against men and women is a choice. Any man that ever tells you that he made a mistake, that's bull crap. Violence against women and girls is a choice. It's not a mistake. And we can't accept when someone says, I made a mistake. We have to hold him accountable. It's a choice. And our choices have consequences. The choice to harm women or children have lifetime implications, both physically and psychologically. I bear that burden. I bear that cross. And I was sharing with Linda yesterday. My mother called me the Sunday after the Super Bowl, about 11:14 p.m. And someone sent her I was at an Unsung Hero event honoring those men and women that are on the ground level fighting and supporting women that have been abused in Houston. And someone must have sent my mother an article. Now you have Facebook and social media. So she calls 11:14 and she says, hi. I said, what's up, Mom? I call her Alma. I said, what's up? And she said, I didn't want you to pick up, but I'm surprised you're up. I said, what's going on? What's on your mind? And she said, I'm proud of you, but I apologize. What are you apologizing for? And she said, I apologize because I was such a bad mom. Oh, so as we do this work, we often, and I have to always be sensitive and striking the right balance of every time I share our story, I'm opening up that wound again. And when my mother, when she reads those things, even though it's great work and someone has to speak up, my mother has to relive every occurrence. And she has to be able to get up each day and walk with pride. So as those who have encountered this, and I say these things not to reopen the wound, but it's critical that we have the right balance so that we're not re-victimizing the victim. I just share that as you walk. Men, as you go out and you garner the other men and you begin to speak out more about it, because I feel like Naples is a pivotal point for where our country can be and where it can go. Why? Because I saw it. I know what I can be by what I see. I've seen greatness here. I've seen what a shelter can be. So there's no more excuses when we travel. So I just share those things. When my mother said that, the psychological damage. My mother today still has not found her place in society. after 30-plus years of this abuse, just trying to find her real value. As she said, I thought he loved me. Well, love doesn't strike. And I just wanted to share that because I still battle with the cycle. I had to forgive so that God can move in my heart. But I'm tormented by it. And I know many are here, but so we all share that same feeling. But I just say, the choice to harm women and children have lifetime implications. Lending your voice and your platform. Use your voice and your platform. And then finally, this was my charge in 2016, and it'll be my charge in 2017. To all men, what does your silence actually imply? When you go back to your clubs, when you go back and you're in your restroom this evening and you're in the mirror, when you go back in your car, you look through the rearview mirror, I just want you to ask yourself, because that's a personal question to yourself, what does your actual silence imply? I love you all. Thank you for having me. Thank you for allowing me to share. Men, if I get invited back next year, not to be a keynote, but if I get invited back next year, if you so to have me come back next year, I would love to see the men, the presence of the men double in size. We can do it. We can actually do it. But Linda, thank you. I want to thank you all for your support of the shelters, doing great work. Continued success. God bless you.